Fun it is. What day is it? I actually don't know. Friday, April 21st, and I am excited to bring you guys here. Come to my face. I am excited to bring you guys a game of a champion I haven't played in a while. At least not in this capacity. It is going to be a tank Fizz game. We're going to go with the one that was a defeat. It's always easy to review victories. I want to bring in some defeats. So this game, the things that strike immediately to me were I wasn't using my W properly. I haven't played Fizz a lot since they kind of changed how his W interacts with the minion wave. It's like basically Annie's Q for last hitting, getting a reset on it. I was doing okay with that in the laning phase, but come later on in the game when I was just trying to do wave management, I was more thinking about the rest of the map and just sort of letting myself auto naturally. I wasn't spreading the dot out over multiple minions, and I wasn't using the W to reset and like get its cooldown, and as an auto attack reset just to shove the wave better. So I could have been doing a little bit better with that. This was a game against an Aatrox who really pushed me to the limit in lane. I felt a lot of push-pull with him in the laning phase, and he got me a couple times. I got him back a couple times. He overextended on a dive once, and that it was just a really close laning phase, and because of that, I'm sure there are things I can learn in watching the replay, so that's exactly what we're going to do. We're going to go ahead and download this. We're going to go ahead and hit play, and we're going to jump right into that replay and start analyzing. So again, tank Fizz, not really my main role my main champion in the top lane, but you know, he's good. There was a time earlier, I think it was last season, during the tank meta when Fizz came out and he was just doing a lot of damage because I think it was percent health at the time, and everybody was just going to giant tanks, Maokai, not quite Mundo, but basically that kind of stuff. So Fizz was really good into that. And I got a little taste of it then, I got a little taste, and the flavor was something I enjoyed, so I figured I'd bring it back out here. Now, that actually shows that I was mid, I just went ahead and swapped with the brand who did want to go mid rather than top, so we just swapped it out, and we busted out the Fizz, so we're going to go ahead and jump forward. I don't believe there's anything too impactful, I think it was just a standard start. It wasn't quite 5 point because it never really is, but just hanging out doing a little dance in the brush. I started with the Dorians. Let me move it like that. Oh, also our jungler was a little late to getting to start, so that's the only real action, air quotes, of the early game. But I started with the Dorians first. The thinking being, whoa. Should I lose some control? Hold on. Let me clear that. Alright, there we go. We're back. So I started with the Dorians. Just for the extra mana, a little bit of damage. Even though I've got it doesn't show on here, but I got Grasp of the Undying, and I've got like tank, a little bit of attack speed runes on. I'm not really going for the AP damage, but it's still nice to have. It's definitely a good starting item, and I was trying to shove out the wave as much as possible so I can get an optimal trade here just from the call for help. And I didn't realize how much of an optimal trade I could get there, right? This was actually pretty surprising to me. Now, the reason I wasn't still fighting him was because I see from his passive, the revive is up. So what I want to do is I want to back off just like I did here. And I didn't play this right every time, but this is a good example of how to play this against Aatrox's Fizz. When I see that passive is up, the blood well is ready, I need to just back off when he's very low, give it time for the blood well to reset back to zero, and then I can all in him. And he'll be so low from the previous trades that I'll be able to for sure win. That's the theory. So he's doing everything he can to keep his blood well up. Eventually, it does drain, so now at this point, I would be ready to go. I'm only level 1 though, so I only have my W right now. If I hit level 2, I can get the Q, and I can all in him. He hits level 2 before me. A little unfortunate. Gets some poke on me. I'm level 2 right behind him. Not too much comes of that. As soon as I hit level 2, even though he got a little level advantage on me, and he got a little poke on me, I'm still way ahead in this. I think he's playing this far too aggressively. Maybe if it was old Aatrox, where you just get the automatic revive on a certain cooldown, and you start the game with it, this would be a little bit more understandable, but he doesn't have this. He has to take time to build it up, so I just all in him right here. I don't think I get the kill. I actually do flash for it, but he flashes as well, so just a trade in flashes there. And now he's so low, he's going to have to base and TP, I would imagine, right? So I'm waiting for that. Seeing that he's back in lane, now I think, okay. Well, let me tell you what I think now, right? Because it's been a few games now, and I have played a tank Fizz game since then, so maybe I might be confusing this a little bit. But this is a situation where, like, I have the utter advantage, right? So I need to position myself somewhat aggressively in the minions, be sure not to take any aggro as they kill off my front line of minions and look to swap to a new target, because I don't want to. I'm still just level 2. I will take a lot of damage from minions if I let it happen. But I need to be careful of that. But aside from that, standing here will zone him all the way back here, like he's at right now. He's actually playing a little bit further back than he needs to right now, but that's because he has J4 coming. So we'll go ahead and swap that vision too, just so we don't automatically know when we're getting ganked and all that. So I'm coming here in here. Don't think I should be pushing that wave in like I'm doing right now. I think I'm still trying to get used to the W, honestly, as part of it. You know, if I could just... There we go. There we go. Very nice. So, I see that he's backed off and he's going back right now, so it's like, alright. If he's just, this is already pushing, I think this is where it sort of clicked in my head. If this is already a wave, since it has far more casters than mine, like double the amount almost, two more, you know, and like some major advantage on the cannon health, this is definitely going to shove in. And if he's back or... like, he's just paying mad respect and he's trying to, like, get some jungle creeps or something right now. Because I don't know these jungle timers. That was from when we had the all cam up. But I'm just going to hang around back here so I can zone him even further back and make sure he doesn't even get XP from these minions dying. Right? Because if he's not going to get the experience from the minions, that's going to put him even further behind. And even if he comes back full health and with a lot of regen, having a huge level advantage is going to make sure that he's going to... any trade he makes with me going forward, he's going to be punished for quite heavily. So, great. Need to just be careful, again, dropping the aggro for the minions. Going for the last hits, that's it. So I'm thinking that we don't know where he is. What I think turned out was he actually went back to base and then just walked back to lane. Because he saw this was frozen and this was... could intuit this is what I was going to do. So he was probably just walking back to lane, which as we see, if we look in the cheater cam, that's exactly what's happening. He's just walking back to lane. But that's great for me. Like, I got no problem with that. If he's walking back to lane right now, this is so much experience he's missing out on. This is time I get to free farm. Great. Fabulous. I will take this any day of the week. So, not that I'm going to hit every last hit here. I do miss a couple here and there. But this is basically just downtime I get to free farm, and he's missing out on so much gold and experience right now. It's just wonderful for me. So, even though it did get within turn aggro range, these four are doing damage to a wave that it should be equalized at. So the wave is still going to be pushing inward for us. So we still have complete control over this wave. Unfortunate that they get a little bit in range here, so that might reset the wave a little bit. But we still maintain what turns out to be an optimal freeze for us. So he's zoned. Again, you see, I have a level advantage on him. Sure, he comes back a little bit full health, but he doesn't have, like, any significant items. He got boots and a long sword. You know, I still have Doran's Ring. That's still roughly equivalent. He's going to have a little bit better sustain with his refillable potion and just being Aatrox than I am. But that's not major combat stats. If we're fighting, I'm going to fight, disengage, and look to re-engage again to stick that damage on him and really put either get a kill or push him back again and make him go through this back cycle he just went through. So not quite zoning him out of experience range right now. Until this moment, actually, I think we saw J4 attempt a gank here. This isn't our first moment seeing him. So I could have been a little bit more aggressive in this, since we did know where J4 was. Even in this replay, I wasn't keeping the best eye on the minimap. but if I had been a little bit, instead of, you know, last hitting from there, if I was last hitting from here, that would force him to play back about that far. Because he just wants to maintain, I think, the same amount of distance as me. But if he's here instead of here, I'm not sure that he's at an experience range for this minion. So I think this minion might not actually go down even. But there were probably a couple here that he was getting experience for that I could have zoned him from if I was playing a little bit more aggressively. Which again, since we know where all their players are currently, I have a little bit more freedom to do to press this level advantage. So I could be pressing that. I think that's a key component of Fizz. Because Fizz, I didn't take Ignite in it with him this game. I took Flash. I think I'm going to start taking Ignite with him. Because he has so much bullying pressure in the laning phase. I think if I take Ignite with him, it's pretty much just an auto win in the lane phase. I'm not 100% sure of that. Certainly depends on your skill. But I think with how strong this felt, playing it more than once today even, I think Ignite would make that really a monster. The kind of monster Fizz I'm used to seeing in games. So, accidentally sped up a bit there. So we could have zoned a bit better. Here as well, we're not really zoning. We're allowing him to stay in experience range. And again, now that I'm going for a minion here, this is actually proper positioning. But when this minion was dying, I should have been here, which would have forced him back to about where he was right now. So, you know, could use a little bit of work with my zoning. And my last hitting a little bit. And again, there's no reason, I don't think, there, it is possible, since we don't know where J4 is anymore, it could have been that I had noticed when he was mid how low he was, so I would know that he's not a major threat to me right now, so even if he did show up, I could just all in J4 and get a kill on him. That would have been some really good map awareness to have, but unfortunately I just didn't have that information, so I wanted to play a little bit cautiously. Make sure I don't get ganked from that brush. Okay, a little bit more understandable. I'm not playing as aggressively as I could, but I am still zoning him out at last hits. He manages to get a couple using some abilities, but those cost health. He's not really securing them fully. And if he decides to go maxing that, that's probably not the optimal build for Aatrox. So that's good too. This ward sort of solves that problem. It allows me to play a lot more aggressively because I can keep an eye on the minimap. And see, this is what I'm saying. I wasn't even really trying to go for just a single auto attack to get the Keystone proc'd, right? Just coming this far forward from when he's right here makes him take his Dark Passage, which has a long cooldown for the non-Aatrox players out there. That's a painful cooldown to use when you don't need to. And it's because he's two levels shy of me, right? So he has to play that defensively. So instead of doing the sort of safe stay back in my minions thing, I should be positioning far more aggressively in lane and sort of forcing him to stay back again, widening this gap even further. And we can see from his experience, it's not too much of a gap. But again, this, I should never allow him to come this close. I should, now that the minions are aggroing back here, being in this general zone is more acceptable because I have to be in range to get these minions when they get low. But denying this cannon is more important than securing either of these for myself. And these have a lot of time left on their health. This cannon does not. I should probably be positioned more around here. So he would already be taking damage from me getting my W dot on him right now, or, you know, queuing to him. That this should already be a bad trade happening for him just to try and get the last hit on this minion. But I kind of just let him take it, you know. And that was about 50 gold that I could have denied him right there. And still, I get a great trade. Imagine if I had started that with one or two more autos with my W passive going. That would have been an even better trade. He might even just have to base and teleport right back in because we have such a big wave pushing. If I had done that, it would have forced him to either come back very low to where I could have all in him and tried to drop aggro using Playful Trickster, or it could have forced him to go back and burn teleport just to not miss even more from this wave. But because I wasn't positioning aggressively enough, I'm allowing him these opportunities to soak all of this gold and experience to save some of his HP without having to burn any of this refillable potion time. I don't think I need to either, but that doesn't really matter too much. It doesn't come into play. And there's no reason for me not to be just turning on my W there to last hit. That's just a mistake. I think it's just me not playing for a while. Right here, since my Playful Trickster, I think, was probably still on cooldown slightly, it might have been, if it was on cooldown, which it actually might not have been, to be honest. It's 17 seconds, but that was a while I used it to go. I don't know. It's probably still on cooldown. If it's on cooldown, I shouldn't take the trade here. If it is, I absolutely should take the trade, and as soon as the turret shot's about to hit me, I should just Playful Trickster away to drop aggro. This is another... He just uses Dark Flight, right? Or Dark Passage? Dark Flight. Dark Passage is the lantern, I think. But since he's already used that, he's just a sitting duck right here. So there's no reason I can't just all in him and then drop aggro at my will. And last time we chunked him for a little bit more than the health he's missing right now, that's almost a kill. Especially if I had taken Ignite this game. So definitely could be positioning a lot more aggressively here. And again, remember, I do still have the ward up, so I'll know if I'm about to get ganked. And I start backing out, because I think, okay, well, there must be a gank coming. But no, he just mind-gamed me a little bit there. Since the minion wave was dying, he thought, okay, he can't really all-in me into my turret, because there's no minions to block for him. Probably wrong. Probably could have got some significant damage and Playful Trickster to drop the turret aggro. The lead is less significant at this window in time because we're only one level away. But nonetheless, every time he goes for a last hit, I should be like right here getting a couple autos in on him. The reason he's able to heal up so much, well, one, just from the use of his W, I'm pretty sure it's still his W, that gives him the lifesteal. But I shouldn't let him have that, you know? I should punish him every time he goes for that. So he either like treads water at his current HP, or he loses more than he gains back. And like he'll probably still go for it just to get the gold. But I shouldn't let him get that for free. That's a mistake. I need to play way more aggressively lane. Not necessarily every time as Fizz, but if I have the advantage like I have here, I really need to press that. Because right now, I'm just throwing the advantage away. This is like, there's no reason being here as opposed to here when I have a ward up. There's no advantage right now. Absolutely none. So, oops, through that. There we go. So I definitely need to be playing and positioning far more aggressively in lane. Like that. That's great. That's all I need to do. Just something like that. And unfortunately, it takes me a while to drop the mini aggro. I use the E to get some damage, so I need to be careful. And he has his passive up right now from his Bloodwell. So I didn't see J4 coming in. I could have reacted here a little bit quicker. But at this point it's like, alright, well I'm dead. So I'm just going to try and pop the passive and at least get that. So I do at least pop the passive. Throw down my ward to start the cooldown on it. Again, why not? J4 is sure to hand the kill over to Aatrox, which significantly catches him up because it's first blood. Right, so this is still a pretty big difference, and he's still slightly behind in level, but from this death timer and the first blood, he's going to catch right back up. Yeah, and we can see he's in level 6 right off that wave. So as soon as I spawn, get the TP out, actually slightly slow. Yeah, I probably could have got that cannon mini if I had pulled the trigger on that a little bit quicker. No, whatever. Nonetheless, just trying to last hit. Fairly easy. Now I'm starting to use my W more properly here. So that's good. It's back in lane. So we know J4 is in mid right now, right? So again, free trades here. Not sure it's the best free trading time because he did equalize this a bit with the first blood. But now's the time to go if there ever is. Especially after he uses the Dark Flight like that. Again, that's one of his major abilities that does a lot of damage and his like only CC really. On cooldown. So I can take this fight. So there I go. I finally do go all in. I use the Playful Trickster fairly early there. I'm not quite sure that's the best use of Playful Trickster, to be honest. Let's look at that again. So I go in, I proc Grasp, which is pretty good. Right now I think this is probably an improper time just because he's positioned a little worse than the minions and I'm not dropping much aggro, I don't think. I wasn't dropping too much aggro from the minions. Him backing up like this further into the minions gives me a nice call for help region. Because like right here, he's got one minion assisting him where I have pretty much my whole wave. So that worked out pretty heavily in my favor. But still, I'm not necessarily sure that was the best time to Playful Trickster. So his passive isn't up right now, even though he has the full blood wall. So I should be killing him right now. Yeah, this is insanely wrong. There's no reason any of that should have happened. Oh, goodness. So, even though he's full blood well, he didn't have his passive. I think it's because it was triggered so recently. Yeah. Yeah. So I think that was just some game knowledge playing against Aatrox. I haven't laned Aatrox often enough to realize that at a full blood well, he just doesn't get it. Again, he gets this exhausted problem to make sure that he doesn't... he'll still get the passive addition to his damage, but he won't get the like GA effect. So I was trying to do what I described earlier where I get him low and then back off. But this was an opportunity and I just let him kill me. So that's unfortunate. That's really too bad. Oh, that was a free kill. That's really too bad. Oh, and I'm very punished by that because I still have my cooldown on my teleport there. So we're going to skip ahead here just to get back to the lane. So unfortunate, definitely unfortunate for us. We don't know what Aatrox has bought just yet. As you can see, I went for the double Doran's for the extra sustain and then I'm going into the Sunfire Cape. Got the armor first. I think it was just a happenstance of like buy timings and what items I could afford to get more efficiently. But also, I think Bomby Cinder is probably the correct way to go just for the ambient harassment. But the armor is really effective against both their jungler and their top laner. So, not that bad. They're both full physical. Armor certainly helps with that. Trying to freeze because, again, he's starting to play back again. I'm not sure that I could beat him anymore. I definitely have a CS advantage still, but I think the kills almost completely mitigate that at this point. If not, like, give him an advantage. But since he's already playing that passively, I'm just going to hang out and let him continue to do that. So I throw down the ward there. Try to get some good damage. Force Darkflight. Some good zone in there. letting him get these off isn't that bad, but again, I don't think I have the advantage I had early game to where I can very aggressively zone. I think this is much more appropriate now than it was early game. And if I had been far more aggressive early game when it was appropriate to be, this wouldn't be happening. I could be aggressive now because I would have very easily snowballed that. But unfortunately, I can't make that work. Go in there. Afraid I'm going to take turret aggro, so I use Faithful Trickster. I throw out the ultimate, but I see he has the GA effect up, so I back off. I think if that's the case, I should probably save the ultimate until, like, after I backed off and want to re-engage when his GA is down. So he's able to heal up quite a bit. And unfortunately, since I don't have any sustain in my kit, makes it a lot harder for me to weather that storm. So this is what I was referring to a little bit earlier. This is a point where he all-ins me. I'm very lucky that I was able to, in going for that last hit, just barely eke out of that AoE for his dark flight there. After doing so, I Q through him to try and pull him exactly the way he's going to finish me off, because this keeps him closer to the turret. Then I go into Playful Trickster. I drop a little bit sooner than I think I have to, because I just want the extra damage. And I think that was wrong. I think it's very lucky that I survived here. And as we see, 14 health, that is incredibly lucky. I probably would have gotten the return kill anyway, but this was extremely lucky that I didn't die here. And again, there's no reason I need to be pushing Threading a Needle this closely if I had just played the early game properly. So, a little unfortunate, but luckily that time it worked out for us. I'm a little cautious of even the minion aggro at this point because it's so close. Seeing the TP, I just back off, take the last minion on my way. Go back, upgrade that to the Balmy Cinder, get myself some boots. Again, a little slow on the TP. I was initially walking the lane until the gank was happening, so that's good. Then I decided to go in. I Playful Trickster just to try and get in position so I can... Looks like I Q and then I ult. I think probably ulting there right off the bat would have been better. Maybe I was trying to save it. I'm not quite sure. I think ulting at the start would have been much better there. But at this point, I've just got so much more damage than he does, and health, that he just can't deal with me. So, good gank there by Nunu. Very optimal timing, and since he had just TP'd the lane, very punishing for him. So, remembering that, I hope I shove this wave as quickly as possible. If that is, in fact, what I'm doing, I should be standing here to get the Balmy Cinder effect on all of them. Yeah, it does look like I'm shoving. Not that bad. I was a little hesitant there, maybe just because I was waiting for J4 to pop out of a bush or something. So then I started looking mid, seeing that Lux is a little bit far forward here. Fortunately, I have no ultimate, so just here to scare her. I go in like that. Fortunately, can't get a summoner, but I do get some good damage. She was on her way back to base anyway, so we're fine. It is nice that there's a control ward there, so we knew for certain that she wasn't going to see me coming. I drop mine here and just do that to get a little vision in case if there was anything in the river. And we're back to top lane. Aatrox pushing the lane in because I wasn't here. It's fine, I'm back now, so I'll happily take this. I think this should all be cleared out before the next wave arrives. Yeah, miss a little bit of it, but... So the wave is going to be equalized here. What I can do, I can pull the wave towards him by aggroing the creeps to me by attacking him. I don't really want to do that again. I do wind up with a level advantage here. As we can see from the items, he hasn't really completed one of his yet. He's starting to itemize a little bit against me. I think this is a little bit stronger than this at the moment. Cutlass isn't bad by any stretch of the imagination, but we've sort of equalized after those kills, so it's just a differentiation in CS and build path, and mine looks like it's theoretically like a little bit behind because he has his two components and a null magic mantle, but having the extra power of a double Doran's probably gives me the edge and the level advantage. So I think I'm playing too passively here. Even though it wasn't like really crushing. It was a pretty crushing kill for him to die when he didn't have TP. Yeah, so I think actually I am going to retract that. I should be the one who's the aggressor again in lane. You know, this is not, I shouldn't let him do this. I think I got psyched out and realizing I wasn't playing properly against Aatrox. I was just letting him zone me for free. So that shouldn't be happening. Takes the Dark Flood in. Get some damage in there. I again think opening with the ultimate is much better. And that flash was absolutely needless. I could have probably just walked out of that. And again, we see he's exhausted or depleted. So I'm seeing the full blood well and just assuming he's got the revive up, and that's just incorrect play by me. So it might have been killable there, especially if I had opened up with the ultimate instead. But this I can't do. I can't just stand here and watch him heal back up. So he takes it in. I do walk out of it, just on the edge. Very good. But now he's back to full health. So this is really bad for me. I've let him sort of sustain back as if there was no engagement. He takes a turret shot, luckily for me, but it's still enough to where he can all-in me. And now that we're finally here, and we've let him engage on his terms, now he does have the GA effect back up. So, you know, if I was playing a lot more aggressive, I could have forced a final confrontation before this passive was up. And now that it's up, I feel like I can't force a confrontation at all. Luckily, just some misplay there. So his flash is forced. Very lucky for me. But certainly something that I can't rely on in the future. So I do need to be pressing my advantages whenever that blood well is depleted or exhausted. And that was some misplay by me. As soon as I saw the Dark Flight start, I should be playful trickstering that. And then wait for him to land and come down on top. And then, let me actually just show on the screen. If instead I had playful trickstered up just in place, right? And then come back down here, I could queue through him and wind up about here. And that would easily be like about that much damage, maybe even more on him. So I'd probably get the kill there and survive because he either, just like last time when I got the first kill on him, he either has to run through the turret aggro range to chase me to try and get the last auto attack off of me, and I'm low, so he might do that. Or he has to leave, and he might just die in trying to leave anyway, because he won't have the blood well up, because it's just not stacked up properly right now. So, that could have been me avoiding a kill, if I had been a little bit more proactive with my playful trickster there. Or just like more, a cleaner execution of reactive play, rather. And seeing that he was coming, kind of like the Fior parry, in seeing that Dark Flight was coming, I should have just immediately playful trickstered so I would get the immunity when the damage and CC came in, and I would have been fine there. So I think it's a mix of both knowing the kit better and playing more aggressively. We're going to go warp speed here. Give me back the lane. Do save the TP. Do opt to walk into lane. So I should be looking for an opportunity to teleport bottom at some point. I think there might have actually, this might have been the point where there was a confrontation bottom, and I was watching the whole time. I was walking the lane, and I just couldn't find a good opportunity to teleport in. Unfortunate. But this summoner can't, I can't allow that summoner to sit there unused for long. And I think that's what happened, so. YouTubers, keep an eye on that and tell me what the timing worked out to be. Again, I missed the opportunity to play for Trickster there, and I think it's pretty clear now in retrospect. I should be using the Playful Trickster just to dodge as much damage as I can. I shouldn't really use it to create distance. I should either use it to drop aggro or to dodge damage in CC. What I can use to create distance is queuing through him and then just walking away. He does out-trade me there. Tries to maintain the blood well passive, but he does eventually lose it when he goes in. Again, very lucky for me. Throw out the ult to get the slow, and I'm able to just all in him there and get the kill. Again, that's just luck for me that he would take an aggressive route like that. Probably thinking his blood well would still be available because he's like still in combat, air quotes. But the blood well is a little bit less forgiving than that. So I am able to get the kill there. That's pretty good play to punish that. But I can't, again, I can't rely on that. So if I had been a little bit more immediate using my Playful Trickster at the start of that confrontation, I mean, putting aside how much like this could have been a one lane easily for me, if I had been more proactive using the Playful Trickster in that engagement right at the start, it wouldn't have been nearly as close, and I would have been able to put a lot more damage onto him early on. Though he might not have all-in me and gone for it if that was the case, but nonetheless, that would have been the right sequence of events. So I'll go back to base. I've got my Sunfire completed. I throw on Ninja Tabbies as well because Lux is their only real source of magic damage. Theoretically, Rakan as well. But he's not too much of a threat. He's not, if he's going like a traditional support build. Some Rakans don't, to be fair. Unfortunately, it's after I've walked all the way to the lane that I find an opportunity to TP. But nonetheless, I'm getting off. I'm actually using the cooldown. Good. I could be a little bit more proactive with it, but it's not so bad. I felt it was a little bit worse than that. In retrospect, it's not really that bad. If I'm TPing, it does put me a little bit of danger for the magic damage, but right now she's pinned mid. So again, these full armor combat stats are very effective right now. Going into some magic resist later on, it's going to be necessary, and we're going to see it becomes more and more necessary. But right now, this is pretty effective combat stats for me. Even mid gank, right? So I see that she's here. Zaya is, right? So I assume she's going to be coming around this way, having seen the TP channel. So I decide to try and meet her here and force a skirmish around here. Since we have teammates wrapping around from this side, if she does decide to go back here, I'm thinking the Nautilus that's coming in right here, as we can see, would be able to cut her off. And in the meantime, Nunu is going to be coming down here to get her anyway. Or is going to focus on Rakan and get him. If Rakan tries anything fancy to get over the wall, boom, Nautilus is right there. So it's my job to try and like keep Zaya funneled in all of this. Because I think we've significantly got the numbers advantage, right? Even with J4 now showing, I think this is like the exact moment where he came into our vision. Because he was at his red. Even with that, it's J4, Rakan, and the missing Zaya to brand Nautilus, Nunu, eventually Ezreal, potentially at least, and me. So it's at least 4v3. It could even become 5v3. Aatrox doesn't have his passive, or excuse me, his teleport, Not that I was tracking that at this point, but that should give us a concrete numbers advantage, even if Flux does decide to peel off and come down to help. So we see, as soon as we have around the corner, she pops back into vision of Nunu. Okay, great. I just path back around this way. It's pretty good reaction time. Great. Playful Trickster to get in. I think it's okay to use Playful Trickster to enter into the combat. It's nice also that I'm going to hit it on both of them. Excuse me. So that's good. I think it's good to use the Playful Trickster in this example. Of course, she's got the ultimate, but she's not able to dodge much damage from me. QW gets a lot of burst. Able to land my ultimate on her, so that gives us a little bit of CC. During that, she goes down. Rakan probably makes her way here. Even with those flashes? No, the last snowball from Nunu has a little bit of a punch to it. Takes him down. Great. In the meantime, Lux was actually able to kill Nautilus solo over here. And Lux is becoming a nightmare. So, not a knock on Nautilus at all. It's just unfortunate that the placement of everybody got jumbled around as such. And I think, actually, it looks like she 2v1. So, let's go back and look at that. Okay. So, J4 was here is what it was. So, they 1-for-2. Just barely, but they did 1-for-2. Overall, it makes it a 3-for-2 for us. And I think getting this executed, especially since we were able to kill Rakan on the backside, definitely was right to focus here. This is just good play by them to capitalize on the attention of the damage dealers, for the most part. Like, Brand does definitely bring damage, and he's a mid-Brand. He's not a support Brand, so he's just bringing, theoretically, raw damage. He has Rod, so not the most, and then cooldown. But still, that's respectable damage, certainly. Just unfortunate that it worked out that way. I think we played that right. Grab the fruit. Heading my way up. Unfortunately, Aatrox was pushing that in. I just sort of acknowledged that that was surrendered. And thinking this, seeing how big the wave was, I was like, I think this turret's just gone too. I could run as quickly as I could up there because I don't have teleport. I used it to go for the fight. I don't think I could make it up there in time to stop him. So I take the wave. I don't actually take any more minions on the way, just because I go there to get this wave picked up. Shove it out to try and create some additional pressure, because they are pressuring mid right now. And it's actually the point of where it's about to break out to a fight. But it did just look like pressure mid. So I wanted to create a lot of pressure top as well. And if I could get some free time alone on this turret, I do have a little bit of attack speed rune, so I could be able to chip away. Engagement actually happens here when Rakan goes in. Then you can dive right back out, so there's not really an engagement. So just hanging out here top, trying to do my thing again against Aatrox. This is what I'm talking about, even right here. Level advantage, punishing him every time he comes in to get those last hits. Dropping turret aggro there. Great. I think that's exactly how I should be playing this. How I should have been playing this all game. And look at that. I haven't been playing that all game, so he's had a much easier time. He's been able to itemize against me now because he's had that additional time. Well, he hasn't really gone into it, but he's itemized for himself. You know? And I'm still out trading him to that extent, right? Even with a level up on his side during that, because it was 11 to 13, now he's 12. That's insane. If I had been doing that all game, this would have been absolutely a 1-1 game for us. No doubt in my mind. Trying to do a little BM just to tilt them. Do a little laugh here and there. Again, this is like equivalent to what I was talking about before with trying to zone him out of even experience range. By standing here, it allows these minions to aggro forward on the other minions and not onto me. And if they do aggro onto me, I can just walk a little bit this way to drop aggro and then walk right back. And then I'm sort of providing a zone like this from me. Maybe even a little bit further forward down from me, where it blocks him from going. So he could start to position more forward this way. But then I would just come in to cut him off and actually force a fight. So this, even though I'm not standing immediately, in between him and the minion wave, this effectively is the equivalent, just because it's parallel to that line, right? Or it's perpendicular to that line. So I bring the same amount of zoning here, and I don't risk aggroing the minions to myself as easily. So I think this is really good, a really good example of how I should have been handling like my aggressive positioning all throughout the game against Aatrox. I'm even able to force out some spells, which does hurt as Aatrox, because you got to use that health to cast your spells. Unfortunately, like, I don't have much time to mess around top, because we're in a serious disadvantage, because we're just a couple kills mid. So there's going to be huge pressure here. So I try and just, like, start shoving this out, so I can get the pressure here to keep Aatrox top, and then I can back and help defend mid. Red team's turret has been destroyed. I mean, with three of them down, this turret is just a surrender in my mind. Going for this turret's defense is what I'm really after. Which I'm able to do. Go over here. Since they don't show on the map as pressuring that, I decide to just keep walking. Great. Walk into the pink ward. Red ward. That way we know where I'm at, they won't see me. Aatrox might be pinging just generally in the area to be careful. But I see Xayah here. Now I know there's three of them there. Or at least I should know, right? But I'm looking for that Xayah. If I can all in her, I can probably kill her. So I'm just waiting, looking around the edge, trying to cheat forward a little bit. I still don't see her. And if she was going to continue to walk this way, theoretically by now she'd be here. So that probably means she went either this way to check for the red buff, or to just try and take a cheeky escape by getting to the blast cone here, which actually isn't up right now. And then she could hop over the Baron Pit. So what I need to do is start rotating up here to look for the catch on her here. We see the Scrying Ward come out, which is covering typically what would be the chase path for us coming in from the Fog of War to follow them. So that gives me even further indication that they're probably just right there. So that's where I go. Well, I stand right on the edge because I'm not exactly sure where they are. And again, I don't know how grouped together they all are, and I want to open up and all in Xayah more than anyone else. So I kind of am biding my time here, just looking for an opportunity. Do wind up walking into both of them in the bot lane. And this is an unfortunate split here. I threw my ultimate forward just immediately point blank to get it out. And I got it on the support, Rakan, instead of the Xayah. But we continue to focus the Xayah because she's just... he's more tanky because he's built some like health support items. And she's so squishy. Just naturally from, like, she has Ninja Tabi. Like, me and Nunu do magical damage. So, and Nunu's actually got himself a Haunting Guise at this point. And a Blasting Wand to back it up. So we're doing real damage to her. So even without my ultimate, we're putting a lot of damage on her. And we are able to take her down, yeah. Then we turn on Rakan. The nice Q from Ezreal. That gives us just enough damage to knock him out. Without problem before Aatrox could come in to contest that situation. So I go back to top because, again, Aatrox was here. He's gone back this way. He's either over here right now or he's down here. Either way, we've got initiative of this part of the map. So I'm going to get initiative here as well to create pressure on the turret. Because we could take this turret right now with three of us on it. So by bringing the minion wave forward, I give an opportunity for them to come from Fog of War out through here And then we can just all attack this minion, or this turret, and take it down with the minion wave to cover us. Unfortunately, we get a little split up here. True. And it's not just that the fight happens, it's that Lux is there and the fight happens. Which is particularly bad for us. So, unfortunate. Ezreal has managed to steal that, I didn't notice that, but that's great. Aatrox is up here with me. So, while that fight is happening, I'm thinking, alright, well, whatever, I guess gotta hold Aatrox with me and be ready to peel back if they come up top. Look for opportunities to fight Aatrox. He knows I'm in this brush. And again, this is kind of zoning without showing myself, so this is alright play. It's not as hard or as aggressive as I could be. We do have pretty good vision coverage here, so I should be able to play a little bit more aggressively. I think this is appropriate play as far as the level of aggression is concerned. If we don't have that good of vision coverage and we don't know, like, okay, well, their bot lane is here. Lux, who's the one I'm really afraid of, is still missing. And we don't know where Jarvan is either. But I think Jarvan had just died, so he's still in base, coming out of base. No, I'm just wrong about that. Where is he? Oh, that's actually Lux. We don't know where Rakan is. Pardon me. And I still don't see where J4 is. Oh, he's engaging. Derp. That's where he is. He's in plain sight, of course. Duh. Okay, well, anyway, so since I have vision of where three of them are, and the only one missing is the support, I should definitely be playing a little bit more aggressively here. Again, I do have a significant level advantage on him, so I need to be making this happen. I'm starting to, like, eke out an advantage, too, just beyond the CS even, in just statistics for the kills. So I need to press that. You know, if I can't be mid, making sure that this doesn't keep happening, you know, I need to be making up for it elsewhere. And if I get a kill on Aatrox and take a turret while that's happening, okay, whatever, maybe that's fine. But I can't be playing passive. So I shove it in. And I try to TP, but I'm just way too late. This is a horrible TP. I'm glad I do cancel it and just be like, alright, whatever. I'm just going to be top and I'm just going to haul any trucks and try and make this work. So, I'm trying to drop his passive, but then I decide against it and just decide, let me try and burn through it instead. I flash into the brush to give myself some time to get my cooldowns back up. And from that, I'm able to just barely get him. So that works out. I think burning through his passive like that, especially when I've got a fairly significant lead now, burning through his passive instead of playing around it is possible. Because at least as Fizz, where I'm an auto, or I'm not an auto attack champion, I am because I have my W, but I'm a cooldown, fairly cooldown reliant champion. But my cooldowns aren't the longest, right? Maybe on my Playful Trickster it's still decently long, right? At this point in the game, it only has 2 points into it, so it's still 14 seconds. But these ones are fairly short. Even if I'm not getting the cooldown on my W because I'm just burning it on him right at the start, that's fine. Which, again, I shouldn't be doing. I should be waiting until it's had the 2 second bleed, right? But these are all fairly short cooldowns. By the time he actually goes through the whole animation to come back from his passive Bloodwell, those cooldowns are back up, and I should be able to just burst him out. So just bursting through his entire health pool is probably the right call there. Since they're backing off, we don't really know where they are, and this river is dark, so I do need to be a little careful. But having gotten the kill, I want to try and add the tower on top. We see that, okay, they are in fact on the dragon. I still don't have TP because I burned it earlier trying to make that play work out. So I think, alright, well, all I can really do is pressure this turret, so I'm going to be sure to at least get this. Actually do get this TP on top for free. That's nice. Means he can't be anywhere else proactive on the map for a little while. Great. So I go down mid. He goes in. At this point, I've realized, okay, Lux is scary. So I'm getting a... I forget if I'm getting a GA or if I'm getting... I'm pretty sure I'm getting a GA at this point. I've got a good amount of health already from the Sunfire Cape and the Trinity Force. And I think, probably plenty of armor. So I just want to get some MR on top. A GA doesn't give me additional health with it, so maybe something like a Spirit Visage would have been better. And in fact, since I have... Where does it show my cooldown reduction? No, it doesn't. There's probably a way to see it. But I don't... I think I had, like, cooldown runes that were, like, 15%, I think. Maybe. Nonetheless, I wasn't quite capped at cooldown reduction. So maybe another item that gives me, like, 10% CDR. And a little bit of health and a little bit of MR would have been good. Maybe a Banshee's Veil even there would be more effective. Because the cast from Lux is what's really going to kill us every time. So I think Banshee's Veil is probably the right play here instead. Because it also just gives me that pseudo tankiness of whatever that first chunk of damage is. It's completely negated. So it's like pseudo health in that way. And since I went Ninja Tabi instead of Merc Treads, I'm a lot more susceptible to CC. So if she gets me with her Q, it's really going to hurt. So I do think that going GA might not have been the best pickup here. Maybe it makes sense as a fourth item. But for what I had in mind, at least, of trying to counter the Lux, I think Banshee's Veil probably would have been a little bit better of a choice there. Nonetheless, we're okay. Nice calm sidestep of Rakan. Fortunately, then J4 is here too, so I'm like, oh boy. Let's start getting the dots on people. Playful Trickster into J4's ultimate to try and get as much damage out as possible. Again, nice relaxed sidestep of Lux ultimate. I'm saying nice relaxed not because like I'm so good, but usually like I'm freaking out when this stuff happens. Getting a little bit more composed during all this and just calm sidestep. Focus, focus, focus. The ultimate, the fish, is on J4 that whole time, so he can't move very quickly. I see Lux is coming, and I actually see this happening before it happens. These minions are going to block me when I try and go like this. So I need to be aware and just try and like really spam like clicking down this way, like clicking right here, to try and force myself to go behind them. Because then I can like get a nice, instead of going all the way around then following her when she's probably going to go back this way, if I can get that extra little bit, then I could be able to get my Q off and Urchin Strike right to her, and then I'm on top of her and she's dead. So, could have been a little bit more proactive with this. I get a little... Oh no, I'm actually okay with that. Actually worked out okay. I thought it went worse in my mind. She was able to get away from that. Probably could have Playful Trickster earlier. I'm a little bit disrespectful of the damage she can push out just because I feel so tanky against everyone else. And I know we have a numbers advantage right now. So playing a little bit disrespectful there. Not like flame disrespectful, just like not smart disrespectful. We go up top to catch this wave. Try and make sure it stays off the turret. This is another example of where I'm not using my W to push this out very well. Just wasn't paying attention to micro. You see this time I'm actually trying to do that and spread the dot a lot more. I think that's a minor thing. I think probably the main thing this game was not being aggressive. Being improperly passive, you know. J4 engages. Okay. Throw the shark on him. Just because he's already in there. Probably not the best target, but... just hoping we could disengage more than fight that. And maybe the slow from that would be helpful. Didn't wind up working out. Grant is able to make it out alive with me. I go back to heal up. And at this point, I still don't have my next item yet with the GA. I think this is where I picked up the chain vest too. I'm going back there. So I'm feeling particularly squishy against the Lux, who's just again become a nightmare of the game. She's 12-0-7, and she's got like a nearing full stacks Magi's, so that's pretty bad. Pretty bad for us. Trying to keep them interested here. Do get the ultimate and Isaiah. Look for a little damage on Rakan because he's low. Flash away, and this is just perfect. Like, this shouldn't have worked. But it just does. They follow me because I'm low and just burn flash. And we actually get the counter engage. Almost died to Zaya there because I'm not paying attention to her feather management. Should have known that I was going to take a lot of damage there. And luckily, she's not super ahead this game. She's doing pretty good for herself, but she's not super ahead. If she was, she could have straight killed me there. I'm almost certain of it. So need to play a little bit more with when Zaya's in the game. I need to be a little bit more aware of her feathers and when she can recall them back to her. Team does clean her up though, so it all winds up working out. And with that, I think I'm able to get the GA. No, not quite yet. Work my way back bot. Again, another good example of just popping his passive and just working right through it. Instead of trying to play around it, it's like... There was a situation in LCS last year where somebody, I forget which carry it was, but one of the carries was about to die, and then their mid zillion ulted him. So everybody in the team stopped attacking him just to let the zillion ultimate time out before they killed him with the last auto attack. And he almost killed like two people. He might have even gotten a kill on one of them just because they were letting him stay alive for that long. So then they ended up having to trigger it and then work through the additional zillion ultimate, the heal that comes out of it. So instead of having hesitated and tried to walk it out and then lost something, or at least lost health on two of their people, they should have just popped it immediately and then just burned right through them upon the resummon. And that's, I think, how I should probably be thinking about Aatrox. What's scary is if once he's Bloodwell healing, if I've got like that much health, then I need to dip. But if it's still comparable once the blood well happens, then I should be able to all in and beat him. That's, I think, the mindset I should bring, especially at least as Fizz, right? So we're going forward here. I'm just trying to push the wave out because we have the super minions coming in. So just trying to manage this wave and create pressure, as much pressure as we can. I doubt we're going to be able to get a kill on them. So just focus on the minions the whole time. Trying to get as much damage onto the wave as possible. TP is coming in from Aatrox. Retreating back. Look to pick up this blue. Fortunately, in the meantime, we get all in mid. Poor management from my mind. Like, it's okay to kind of have this arc here, because as you can see, like, this is where the action just happened mid. So having two of us positioned right here allows Ezreal to push in and try and get this turret, which he is going to do, right? But they just happened to get a good engagement here, and now we lost Brand. And it's like, that's probably not worth it then. Because if it was like a trade for just Brand, for just an outer turret, maybe, since at this point in the game we need to just even up the gold advantage team wide, maybe that's a good trade. But they have super minions already streaming in. This is vulnerable. We're out of position. We're way out of position to defend this. It's a bad spot. We shouldn't make a trade like that. So maybe I should have stuck around mid more, because again, Nunu was already sort of providing that cover just by being at blue, taking blue himself. So maybe providing my team a little bit more support falling back as the tank for the team, you know? Might be that I was thinking too much of Fizz in the terms of, like, AP mid Fizz, and not as much as, like, be the tank of the team. So I'm there getting my GA and then, like, hesitating a little bit. as I try and like grab another ruby crystal. That's just something I need to work on. Hesitating a little bit less. Throw out the fish, unfortunately misses. But at this point, I'm just like, you know, I have my GA now. So let me just like go in, do as much damage, try and work my way back to my team afterwards. Which I start doing while trying to get the dots on them. Whatever, I res from the GA. I think I probably would have been okay with the playful trickster. Turns out I'm not. Turns out I die there. We are able to force him back after all that. But unfortunately the super minions come in, make that a little bit temporary. Nice pick was found. A little bit of an overextension on their part. Stars aligning. Work out for us, so we're able to make that happen. At this point I say just go straight to Baron. Because I have TP up, I can TP in for support. Watching the mid wave here. Need to defend this turret. So when I respawn, didn't take an extra second there, but probably couldn't defend that anyway. Trying to clear out the mini wave as quick as I can. We get the Baron, so this becomes even easier. Fortunately, J4 is right here, and he does interrupt the respawns. At this point, I need to just call it. You know, that's unfortunate. We're going to lose two. I make the wrong call. And I felt obligated since I had said in chat I can come in for support. And I thought, well, I can always playful trickster over that wall, worst case scenario. Didn't work out that way. I had to use playful trickster early just to dodge damage, and then I just wind up dying. And then that's the fight that cost us the game, because the follow-up to it, they just get chased down. So, at the end of the day, some misuses of the teleport, you know, come in too late. Fights just go right. Not much to say about this. I just finish it out. Pretty clean. I come in, try and do what I can. Nothing matters too much. The teleports are coming out a little bit too late for me. They're not necessarily coming out at the wrong times or for the wrong engagements. They're just coming out at the wrong times for those engagements. They're just too late. I wait until it's decided and then I teleport in. So that's a little bit better teleport play. But more specifically, and what would have been, again, a much greater impact in this game, because if this was instead, like, you know, I was 13, 5 and 8, and this Aatrox was, like, instead of 5, 7 and 3, he was, like, 2, like, 11 and 3, just kind of roughly making up those numbers, because I had been playing that lane so much more aggressively, and the CS differential was way more, so he had even less CS than Brand, who was like in the worst matchup in the game by far with against that monster Lux. Like, if I could have made him feel absolutely useless that game, then maybe we would have been able to win that one. And maybe I would have been so much stronger that when I started getting involved in these fights, even if I was a little slow on the teleports, which does happen, I don't play top lane too much, so I'm not going to rag on myself too much and be like, oh, the whole theme of today's episode is poor teleport play. Like, that'll come back. Rusty, admitted, but that'll come back. What I think is something that just needs to be flat out worked on is playing the Fizz more aggressively. And recognizing when I have an opportunity to take control of the lane through aggressive positioning. And not just try and like zone to where they have to try and farm with abilities, but zone where they can't even get experience. That's the kind of aggressive presence, aggressive lane presence that I should be exerting when I had so many opportunities to just be ahead. And even when I lost those opportunities and started to fall behind, I still came back and started getting kills. You know, I was still stronger in that situation than Aatrox was consistently throughout that whole game. And I just didn't play like it. And because of that, I gave him a lot of opportunity to just run away with the game. And while he wasn't necessarily the one that ran away with it, him not dropping the ball any harder than he did, which wasn't honestly that bad. Like, this is not the best scoreline, but it's not enough to throw a game, especially when you have a Lux who goes off like that with a perfect game of 14-0-10. That's just insane. I need to be the thing that was mitigating that. And we see at the end screen, like, I was the opportunity for our team to mitigate that Lux. And I just didn't. Because I didn't capitalize on Aatrox's advantages that were presented to me in lane. And I didn't have that presence from the extra gold from that, from the extra experience from that, from the extra items, but all that transitions into, to make myself something that Lux couldn't stop. Instead, Lux was something that I couldn't stop. And when I lose control like that, that's why we're here. That's why it says, it actually says victory. But this was a loss for us, for our side. So it didn't have to be that way. I think this was an absolutely winnable game if I had just taken a more aggressive stance in lane. So unfortunate, but a good lesson. And as you saw later, I played another Fizz game. I'm not sure that I played it very aggressively. I might do just a review for my own learning off camera to re-examine that. But definitely went better. Definitely went better for us that game. I really think that was a one game if I had played that more aggressively. So let me know what you guys think. If there was any aspect of the game that you think I could have done better. Or needed more improvement than just my how I sort of carried myself as far as aggression and tempo went. If you think there were other aspects that were more important that I was missing out on, definitely let me know. Happy to do a re-review and like look at that to analyze that feedback, see if there's any more opportunities for growth. I think this might just be the most glaring one. I'm sure there's several ways that we didn't go into that I could improve. But this was the one that made itself most apparent. So that's what we focused on today. Hopefully you guys can take something from that for your own play. I know something in top lane is just, it feels like the wet noodle fight, very boring, very standard, and the action happens when they teleport around the map and start making plays elsewhere. I think this is a good example of why that's not the case. Top lane, all throughout that game, if you were watching live on Twitch, you saw all the neck and neck of going back with Aatrox felt like a really hard push and pull back and forth. And I was barely getting those kills to catch myself back up. And then I was barely able to zone him. It felt very contentious at every point in the game. And I was really engaged in that. And if I was able to not just be engaged with that, but recognize that situation a little bit more holistically and have seen the potential, if I had taken a more, a more aggressive stance, you know, that's just what it comes down to. When I'm playing Fizz, who's an aggressive champion like that, if I was playing Renekton, you better believe I would have taken an aggressive stance. You know, there's no reason I shouldn't be taking the same thing as Fizz. Even if I'm going, transitioning into the Sunfire, transitioning into the full tank build, the GA, it doesn't matter. I'm a Fizz. I'm a tank Fizz. I will kill you. And I will outtrade you. And I need to act like that. Just like a Renekton would. You know, if a Renekton has a whole bunch of tank items, he still acts like he can kill you because he can. So I think I just need to grab that mentality for myself. Play Fizz a lot more aggressively in lane. Exert that presence. Exert that dominance. Force the situation to be one that comes out in our favor, and we can win games like that easy peasy. So thanks for watching. I hope you guys, again, were able to glean something from that, add that to your play, maybe get out there, try out Tank Fizz if you haven't already, play him aggressively, go a little bit too hard and die sometimes, but then get the sense of it, you know? I certainly know that's what I did the first few times I played Tank Fizz. So thank you again for tuning in. And stay tuned. We'll have another episode out for you guys soon. Oh, not that one. We're not on a break. We're done.